Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all my blessed beloveds out there in video land. You're watching Living and Thriving with Rusty, and well, I'm Rusty. And today is a gorgeous Saturday. The sun is up. It's huge. I can't even tell you how excited I am to have another day to be ornery. How many times do you wake up and say, oh, I get to be ornery. I get to choose my path, choose my day. I can be happy, sad, grumpy, a curmudgeon, or I can just stay in bed and read a book. You have these choices. What kinds of choices do you make every morning? I'm super excited. My guest today is Tedi, and it's all about the blues.
Hi there.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm really good, but I was a little confused because it says Oliver, and you're not an Oliver, are you?
No, I'm not. Okay, how do we change that here?
Are we being punked?
No, this there's a way to change it.
That's okay. Are you going to come on live, or are we just going to see?
Rename. Hello. Oliver is my grandson.
Oh, hi, Oliver, grandson.
He's 5. He didn't do that. I think when I originally signed up for Zoom many moons ago.
There you are.
I was staying anonymous. Oh. So I used his name.
Ah, gotcha. Secret's out now.
You must get this too, because Rusty's can be a boy's name too, right?
You know what's really funny is that in any other country in the world, there's a recognition that I or IE is feminine. In America, nobody paid attention to eighth grade English.
Yeah. I mean, I just had to buy a domain for Teddy Brunetti because when they hear Tedi, I didn't know. I was 4 years old. They said, you spell your name Tedi. I mean, you know, what did I know? But Tedi, in case, you know, for search engine optimization, if somebody just hears my name, it's possible they're going to search for Teddy instead.
Isn't that bizarre? It's like Nobody showed up to eighth grade English. Nobody in America.
Oh, we're the worst. We're the worst. No one can spell anymore either.
I have a hard time with spelling myself.
I took when I was in college, the last time, I had several professors that if you spelled a word wrong, they deducted points. So I wasn't going to allow that. So that's when I learned how to spell.
So are you able to turn on your video, or is it just me and the black screen?
Oh, no. We're not on video. Start video. There. Can you see me now?
There you are. There's a beautiful woman I stalked on Google. Professor Google gave me all kinds of rumors about you, like you're a hot-ass, badass mama.
Oh, you think so, huh?
Yeah.
That's what we want you to think. You are too. Listen, I stalked you too. I've been watching some of your shows, and I can't wait to have more time to sit down and really just enjoy some of your interviews. You get some interesting people.
I do. And yeah. I feel really fortunate. And I rarely ever have music people on, just so that you know you were put up on the gonna have, because I think you fully represent and embody what an amazing badass woman should be. So,
well,
that's my praise to you.
Thank you.
It's amazing what you've accomplished and what you've done and kind of the road that you've carved out. And when you started, it wasn't quite friendly for women to be in your position. So I kind of want to, I know my stocking, and I'm so excited to have you on. I feel like a little kid at Disney. Tell us who you are, what you do, because not everybody watching this got to stalk you like I have. And let's get into the juice, because you're ooey gooey. I love it.
Well, I'm Tedi Brunetti, and that's actually my maiden name. I sing, I write, and I play the drums. And I have an album coming out, and I'm going to be 69 in another week or so, June 8th. And it's really exciting at this age to have a second chance at a music career. I had a band in New York City in the 70s and 80s. And then we had our two sons and came back to Pittsburgh to raise the kids. I went back to school for ultrasound. So I've done the yin and yang of sound. I did cardiac and vascular ultrasound for 20 years and then retired 8-9 years ago and got back to, I knew I wanted to play again, or at least I wanted to try. I didn't know if I'd be able to. I didn't know if physically someone in their 60s could, as a drummer, okay? Because I'm in love with drum technique and all things drums. If I could get the speed back up in my hands, if I could do, you know, what I could do. And I'm here to tell you, you can do anything you want at any age you want. If you persist, if you go slow and take it easy and build, and like for me with the drumming, I built my technique on a drum pad. You know, I went to college for a couple of years. I actually had a scholarship for snare drumming. So I had to learn a whole new technique and, you know, I did it. I was persistent. My husband retired after me. So I had a few years where I was home alone and I would spend 6 hours a day hitting that drum pad. I still practice. I just love it. It's a Zen thing for me. I go into a meditative state, I think, while I'm practicing on my drum pad.
I think it's awesome because drumming is a very difficult timing. You have to be incredibly focused. You miss one little half measure and you ruin the whole damn thing. And it's very physical. People don't understand how physical drumming really, I mean, it's core exercise. So, you know, to be 69 in a week, you don't look it, so homage to living a full and beautiful life, but holy smokes, get it, girl.
Yeah, I mean, it just takes persistence and consistency, you know? And as far as the aerobic aspect of drumming, it's amazing. I have incredible aerobic strength for someone my age. And, you know, I worked in cardiology. I did echocardiograms and one of my still friends, cardiologist that I work with, when I told him how hard I work out, because I do a treadmill. I can't lift weights because the ultrasound job pushing on, you know, who needs their hearts tested? It's not the little skinny guys. It's the 300 pounders. So you have to push that transducer between people's ribs. It isn't like waving a video camera. So all that pressure, all those years, I had severe tendonitis in my elbows. I mean, I had shots of cortisone and you can do, you know, Tommy John syndrome, the like baseball pitchers get, you can ruin your tendons to the point where you need surgery or you just can't use your arm anymore. I mean, I couldn't lift a cup of coffee without being in pain when I finished my ultrasound career. And I had, and lifting is the thing that ruins your arms, okay? So when you have tendon problems like that. And so I favored my right hand, I'm right-handed, so I favored that by lifting everything with my left hand for like the last 5 years of my career, and my left arm became worse than my right. So I was screwed up when I stopped that, and I didn't know if I'd be able to play again. But luckily, no more pain. I'm good, you know.
So what is your son's, you know, what do they say? Are they like, hey, that's my mom, she kicks ass?
Yeah. I mean, they're both creative souls. And my husband's my lead guitar player. So, you know, they come from a, you know, a musical artistic family. Yeah.
That's
my parents were actors.
Oh, wow.
Ah, in their retirement. And when that's how they met. And my life has kind of followed the pattern theirs did, you know. But they went to New York and tried to make it as actors. And then came back to Pittsburgh and had their family and then retired and started their acting careers again. And I've done the same thing with my music career. But our younger boy's a musician, and he actually plays on this new album. There's one song actually that there's a father-son guitar solo. So, you know, I got to do things this time around that over the years of doing this in the sweatshop and in the doctor's offices and hospitals doing that ultrasound, I would fantasize about, if I ever do another album, I think I'd like to have some of my sisters sing on it. I'm the oldest of 10 children. So I have six sisters and three brothers. One of my brothers sang on my first album in New York. And so this time around, I had two of my sisters sing some background vocals for me. And I got to have our son play on a song. So, you know, a lot of those kind of wishes that I had came true. I mean, I'm living the dream.
See, and that's the way it should be. And I love the fact that you made it a family affair. What's the album's name?
Well, it's called The Queen of Pittsburgh. And I'm not saying I'm the queen. Now, this is my producer, Dino, who started this business. He came to Pitt, he produced my first album in New York 30 years ago. And we hooked up over Facebook. I found his wife on Facebook. And so he was making a trip from, he lives in the Poconos now, and that's 6 hours from Pittsburgh. So they were making a trip across the country and they stopped in Pittsburgh. We hooked up. I said, hey, Dino, you know what? I'm thinking of recording again. He said, let's do it. And I was thrilled because we had so much fun. And the first album's so good. It still holds water. So our guy from Sony in the Orchard, he wants to release it. And we're going to release the first album after this new one. But anyway, Dino Sargent and Mike Hennigan, my two producers and my bandmates now, you know, they're all in. They started coming to Pittsburgh to do pre-production. We were trying to find material. I started writing again. And I collaborated with Dino on a few of the songs. So he was here, and I have a loft. I live like a rock star. We have a loft in downtown Pittsburgh, and I have a beautiful view of the city. And I love Pittsburgh, and we took them around and showed them the town. And on their way back to the Poconos on one of these trips, he calls me from the car, and he says, I have a song idea, and it's called Queen of Pittsburgh. And you can do, he always says this, so he always says, You can do whatever you want with it. If you want to use it, if you think you can do something, do something. But every time he's done that, I've ended up writing a song. So I thought, when he said Queen of Pittsburgh, I thought, here comes the hate, you know, because everybody here is going to think, oh, who's she? She thinks she's the Queen of Pittsburgh. And no one's heard the song yet because it isn't released. So the idea is, I'm not going to stop kicking ass until they make me the Queen of Pittsburgh.
Oh, and, girl.
And that's the song. And the song, I really love that song because I speak to the history of Pittsburgh about, I bring the steel mills into it and how it's, you know, we've had a revolution here and now all of a sudden we're a tech place, robotics, and we have a brain trust, Carnegie Mellon, you know, university and things like that with robotics and all the tech people were here, Google. You ever hear that app, Duolingo? Mm-hmm. That fella was a Carnegie Mellon guy, and Duolingo's headquartered here. You know, he has an interesting story.
I would absolutely live in Pennsylvania in a heartbeat, but when I started doing other people's taxes for a living, hell no. You guys get taxed like crazy.
It's crazy here. I'm here because of my family. I could live anywhere I want, really, you know. But we knew our parents. And my husband, his only sister had passed away. So his mother, this is a while back now. We didn't want her to be alone in her old age. And we helped her to the end. And my mother passed away a couple years ago. And my dad's 93. So I have those longevity genes. And I feel like I'm middle-aged.
You look like you're my age. So, I mean, the drumming and the spiciness and the excitement and the love for life is written all over you.
And the Loom Pro light washes those wrinkles away.
Don't tell our secrets.
Yeah, and the eyelashes. That's a loan payment right there.
My daughter does that too, and I'm like, we both have naturally really long eyelashes, but she uses the same kind that you do. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, why do you bother? You have such beautiful eyes. And she's like, but mom. Like, okay, whatever, you do you.
Yeah, well, when you're doing these Zoom interviews and podcasts and posting, you know, now with this album, you know, I'm not retired anymore. I'm in show business.
You know, let's talk about that really quickly, because I think it's, you have a unique perspective, not only as a female drummer in a world that was very challenging to be a female in anything, much less be a drummer, because that was like the dude's dude kind of sport. But you really did kick ass and you made a name for yourself. And talk to us about that transition, what it's like then when you really had to struggle, and now everybody's like knocking on your door going, hey, Tedi, let's do this thing.
Well, you know, it's funny, when I first went to New York in my early 20s, I couldn't get auditions because they didn't think girls could hit the drums hard enough. You know, and actually drums is my second instrument. It goes all the way back to the beginning for me, because when I asked to play the drums, my parents said no, because they thought it was a boy's instrument. So I asked for what I thought was the next best thing, guitar. And they allowed that, and they actually bought me a guitar because I was doing so well with my lessons. And it's paid off. Things happen for a reason, I guess. God had a plan for me there, because that's how I write my music now, is on guitar. My guitar playing has really fallen by the wayside, but my husband's a guitar player, so I'll scratch something out on the guitar and teach it to him, and then he can play it properly, and that's how I write. So nowadays, it's a double-edged thing. I had one of my drum teachers here in Pittsburgh, who's a world-class drummer, David Throckmorton. He said, well, it works both ways. Girls, you know, people don't expect much when you're a female drummer, and sometimes you get more credit than you deserve because you're a female drummer.
Gotcha.
And that's, you know, it's that backhanded compliment kind of thing. I think that's more hurtful than anything, because I work so hard at it. But people know, you know.
But you're at a place in your life where you probably don't give a shit anymore. Like,
well, yeah.
What you want to think, I'm rolling with it because I've had 69 beautiful years of my life and I'm good. And if you don't like it, you know how to turn it down.
Yeah, I really don't even have a bucket list, you know. I always just do whatever the hell I wanted to, you know. So, and I'm the kind of, but that, and I say, you know, we're laughing about that, but I get myself into things because I'm the kind of person who, whatever I do, be it cooking, whatever I do, I try to do the best that I possibly can. Somewhere in my youth, I heard, do the best you can do. And I took it seriously. It's part of my character now. So I throw I don't do halfway things. It's hard for me to relax because of that.
Yeah.
I'm learning in my old age, you know, meditation practice, which I'm not great at by any means, but I could get better at that, I guess. I'm enjoying my husband and our lives together. You know, we'll be married 44 years in July, and it's just, I just feel so blessed. And it's like I have this kind of life now that if you would have asked me to wish for it, I never would have wished for it, because it's too much.
You didn't know what to expect either. I mean, life has this beautiful way of unveiling things that we never had in our wish list because we didn't know it existed.
Right, right. I never thought things would work out the way that they have. You know, we struggled, as everybody does. You know, I think raising kids is hard, you know.
It's bittersweet. I would have loved to have the opportunity to have like 10 of them, like your mom. You know, what a blessing to have all these little munchkins and personalities and challenges and motivators and, you know, ones that you want to strangle sometimes because we're human. That's normal.
Right.
Not to actually strangle them, just metaphorically. Please, guys, don't strangle each other, literally. But, you know, I have the one and she's an adventure on her own and I'm proud of her. She's pretty amazing. So you take what you get, you know, you have your trajectory and then all of a sudden God goes, hey, guess what? Plot twist.
Yeah, I guess I didn't have to do, you know, I'm the oldest of all these kids. So every year there was a new baby. And my youngest sister is, I'm 16. I was a junior in high school when she was born. So, you know.
Auntie Tedi.
Yeah, well, she's my good friend today, you know. Yeah. I mean, it's, she caught up.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah. And so I guess I had all those babies all the time. I really didn't need to have all of those babies myself. But there's 6 years, there's 6 years between our boys. So, yeah. You know, I wanted to have one right away. But my husband, after the first, and it was the happiest time of my life, raising those kids. And because, you know, I waited. I was 30 when I had the first one. And 30
yeah, that's what I had mine. Yeah. That's a good age, I think. I think you're kind of out of your ass a little bit. Like, you know, in your 20s, you have your head up your ass and you know everything. And you just have this vigor about superiority, I think. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden when you hit 30, something shifts. You're like, oh, I'm really stupid. This is cool. I got to start over and learn how to walk again, metaphorically.
But nobody tells, you know, and then my generation, we were the first one where we could have it all. You can have a career, you can have a family, you can be this and that, anything you want. But nobody told us that when you wait until your 30s, you're going to have menopause and puberty in the same house. Nobody talks about that. It's a nightmare. It's crazy.
We'll have to co-author a book on that one. What it's like to be menopausal and starting your period.
No, the children. I know.
Oh, puberty. Okay. Puberty. You're fine. Girl house. Sorry, you got a boy house. Different term.
Oh, yeah. Well, oh, God. Yeah. I have a granddaughter now who's 12, so.
Yeah, you're feeling it. Mm-hmm. So, Tedi, we're almost done today, which makes me sad because I really enjoyed you coming across my email. And again, I don't normally take musicians, but your story, I think, is a huge inspiration to women out there who beat to their own drum, so to speak, and want to have somebody to look up to and stalk maybe and learn more about with strength and power and that finesse that you have. I just love it. And I'm going to cordially invite you to come on my radio show so that you can actually, if I think it was Michael that sent you to me.
Yes.
He can send me some MP3s or something and we can talk about the actual music because.
Oh, good.
Well, I think that is huge, especially for someone like you who paved such a huge way and awesome.
I want you to hear my lyrics.
Yeah, I can't believe that. So drum writing, music writing and lyrics, we have a whole nother show because that's not an easy thing to do.
I pride myself on my songwriting.
Yeah.
And really it's one of the things that gives me the most joy is just when I come up with a song, you know, and I make myself laugh. I try to imbue my sense of humor in my lyrics. It just happens. I mean, it's not like I try. It that's just how I write. I'm just, you know, at this point, I'm comfortable in my own skin and I'm able to be myself. And, you know, that's what I like about you because you're very comfortable in your skin. And when we are comfortable, we don't realize what a gift that is to each other, especially women, you know. When we're comfortable in our skin, it allows everyone around us to be comfortable in theirs. you know? So, yeah, that's, it's, what a lesson. Too bad it took me 70 years to figure it out.
Well, I think we have this delightful journey to go through. And in order to get good with who we are, we have to get good with what we are. And when we realize that, it becomes a different journey. This is my favorite part of my life. I am just loving life in a way that I didn't even think was possible. And this is my 45th year surfing this rock. And I can't, you know, I've got a good 60 years left in me. So, you know, watch out, world. You have no idea what I'm going to do, because I don't either. So that's the fun part, right?
Right.
So Tedi, as we wrap up, I want people to be able to find more information about you. So dish on your social media or your websites or wherever people can look you up.
The best place to find me is my website. It's tedibrunetti.com. That's TEDIBRUNETTI.com. And I'm on the social media sites, Facebook and Instagram. Instagram is Tedi Brunetti Official. Facebook, I think you can just search Tedi Brunetti again, TEDIBRUNETTI. And I have a single dropping May 25th from, it's the first single and video. I want you to see my videos too. I have next level video. And the album drops July 20th. It's on
that's
the
amazing. Stream,
all streaming platforms. You can get a CD copy. I'll try to get you one.
Thank you. I'm going to have to, this show technically doesn't air until October. So oh, okay. I'm going to have to move some things around, or maybe just do two shows in 1 week in July. What, July what?
20th.
All right. So I'll air this before that. And that way.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Well, I appreciate you. You're really.
Aren't you a doll?
Huh?
You know, I tried to do my homework on these things. I looked at your YouTubes and things, and I thought, oh, this is, she's my kind of girl.
Yeah, thank you so much. I love what I do. I get to connect people and perspectives and travel all over the world, so to speak, with an authentic approach, I think.
Oh, very much so.
It changes the story. It changes the narrative from something that's canned and fake to having a real conversation like real people should. I think we need more of that in this world, and if that brings joy and inspiration, that's, I'm all for it, right?
Right. And that's one of the things this music career now has done for me, is I love meeting people and talking people. I love people. So and I talk to everyone. You don't want to be in an elevator with me. And
that's what my daughter says about me. She's like, do we have to go grocery shopping, Mom? Can we go to a strange town?
Right. So, I mean, it's bringing a lot of new, interesting people into my life. And like you, I mean, I never would have met you. It's
I know. And I'm going to be traveling through your state in about 2 weeks. So if I have a chance to hit Pittsburgh, I might just ring you up and say, hey, you want a cup of coffee?
Yeah. Yeah,
that'll be as quick as it goes, but
yeah, let's go have a cappuccino. Sure, definitely.
Awesome.
I would love that.
Please do that. So, Tedi, it was really nice to meet you, and I will circle around with some more information about putting you on my podcast, because that is far more international. As you know, my YouTube channel is a baby. It's growing. Mm-hmm. But we can share your music, and it's an hour. So we'll be able to talk a little bit more in depth about your process and what it's like to write songs, which I know is very hard. So.
Oh, good. I can talk about that.
Awesome. I'll see you soon.
Love you, Rusty.
Love you, too.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, thanks for coming on. You just made my day.
Thank you. You're beautiful. Thank you very much.
You're watching Living and Thriving with Rusty. I'm Rusty, and I get to do this. Oh my God. Wait until you go and stalk her. She just is a hot ticket. She's like my mother from a different generation. I mean, she's a seed planter. Good old Rhythm Farmer. That's it, a Rhythm Farmer. That's your new song, Tedi. Rhythm Farmer. I hope to get to physically meet her one day as I finally find my school bus to rebuild and hit the road and do this live face-to-face, because that's really what gets my soul going. Know that you're beautiful. Know that you're loved. Do something kind for somebody, because you know what? You never know how that affects them and what trajectory they're on. Look the word up, trajectory. That's a hard word to say, especially when you have a lisp. But you can really change somebody's life by buying them a cup of coffee. You don't even have to make it like a social media fanfare weird thing. Just be like, hey, dude, I want to secretly buy this person a cup of coffee. And their heart will explode with joy. Go out and explode some hearts. Do something nice for somebody. Pay for somebody's toll. Donate at the food shelf. Just be kind, man. We need more of that. Love each other. Go have fun. Finger paint. I don't know. Get creative. Until next time, know that you're loved.